Welcome everybody, Christina, Mike, Suzanne, James. Last time we were together, it was right before the launch of the Ryzen processor. We were on the Austin campus like we are today, just in a different part of the campus. And we were incredibly excited that we were about to bring Zen to the market for the first time. And there were all those millions of people who were so enthusiastically waiting to get their hands on it. It's a year later. We just passed the 1 year mark since we put Ryzen in the market. And we thought it would be a great idea for us to get back together and talk a little bit about your perspective on the last year and what you're thinking about, you know, what you've been up to since and what's coming up next. So Mike, maybe I'd start with you. You, as a reminder, were the chief architect on Zen. And one of the things that I was amazed to see as we brought Ryzen to market, the first Zen product, was how deeply you got involved in optimizing and working with some of the different ISVs, especially the gaming ISVs, to deliver an even faster, better gaming experience. Can you talk a little bit about that process of, you know, as chief architect, working with game developers, working on source code to make the gaming experience even better?
Sure. Yeah, well, one of the nice things about designing an x86 processor is kind of the backwards compatible, large established code base, and the games just can run out of the box. But just because they can run doesn't mean they're going to run great, right? And so the developers, of course, they have to develop their games to run on a lot of different hardware. So they have a lot of different knobs. Kind of first order, you look at kind of the knobs to make sure the product's tuned right. Yeah. for our new architecture. But then we go deeper and we work with them. We have the ability to look at how their software is operating, see how it could get better on our architecture. And because of all those other architectures, we make sure that it doesn't cause anyone else to lose performance. But while the other products in the world get better, we get even better with that tuned experience. So, you know, myself and my team got involved, worked directly with the developers, got a lot of feedback both from the software side of the world and helping them understand our hardware and using our understanding of our hardware. And yeah, we were able to make some big improvements in the product.
Absolutely, we saw that, and that continued to play out for weeks and months after the launch of the first Ryzen 7 processors. And would it be fair to say that a lot of that heavy lift, if you will, is about the front end of bringing a new architecture to the marketplace? For example, we know we have new generations of Ryzen coming. Is that how you would characterize it? That's new architecture required a little different effort than typical?
It typically does, and they're on the cutting edge, and their game cycles take a lot of time too. So they've been looking at architectures, but when you introduce a new architecture, it can, need a little bit more tuning to find the sweet spot of where the performance lies. So,
got it. Okay. Yeah. Well, it was definitely an impressive effort. And Suzanne, we talked a little bit a year ago together about your role in leading so much of the engineering effort for Zen. And if you think about the phrase, what a difference a year makes, you're in a completely different role working on completely different products as we sit here today. So what do you, as you now work on our graphics technologies as part of our Radeon Technologies Group, what do you take with you from the experience of building Zen into building our next generation of GPU products?
Well, a lot of what we did in Zen was really trying to push well beyond what we thought we could do. And I think that is something that we are trying to do in the graphics space as well, to make a bigger leap forward. We've pulled in some of the expertise from the cores team, the microprocessor cores team, into the graphics team right now, kind of helping with our methodology and, you know, improving our frequency and, you know, performance and power, and just taking the best that we have already developed in-house and trying to make sure that we're using those same improvements across the company.
You talk about there, you know, Zen, the name Zen was chosen for that balance between power and performance, right. And that sounds like that's very much the direction that you and the team are driving things from.
Yes,
a graphics
absolutely.
Technology perspective.
Right.
Outstanding. So Christina, let me come over to you for a second. You're part of the marketing team. You actually didn't join us last time, so welcome to the club.
Thank you.
You worked on everything from designing with your team the Ryzen logo itself and the name, to the packaging, to the marketing strategies. Talk a little bit about that process of now, 1 year later, having seen it grow to be a successful product in the marketplace and some of the reaction that you've seen from people.
Well, you know, we were working on it far ahead of launch, and so it was really hard to anticipate what the community was going to say when they saw all of it come out. And starting from New Horizon before it was launched, the reception within the community was just outstandingly positive. It was, and when the product came out and they saw how great it was performing, how much fun they could have with it, it just exceeded all of our expectations.
Yeah, absolutely. It was just fun to watch the team go through that process and at some of these events to get to connect with people firsthand and have them talk about what their experience was with the product. So James, you were very much hands-on throughout that whole process and leading the effort of kind of defining some of the Ryzen products and defining the strategies, everything from the cooler strategy to the product definition and the rest. And then you continued that on into products like Ryzen Threadripper. And the mantra that I hear you and the team talk about is that sense of products that are built by enthusiasts for enthusiasts. Can you talk a little bit about that for us?
Yeah, absolutely. It was, that was a Skunkworks project that was a dream come true.
This is Ryzen Threadripper.
Threadripper, absolutely. Yes. Is, you know, we sat down and we saw the potential because these guys are just given this wonderful core and this great way of putting things together by having this possibilities of doing two die in a single package, and it seemed to me so easy and obvious a step, right? And it was just fantastic to see everybody else agree, right? The whole company, we started off working nights and weekends and clandestine calls, but turned it into a real product and made it into a real business. And it's wonderful to see how positively it's been received, the ongoing success, the great support we've had from marketing and engineering, and everybody just pulling it together to be this thing no one could have dreamed of, 2 years ago. Could AMD be in this space at this performance level and sustain it? And a resounding yes.
Yes.
Easy, almost. I say easy, it was blood, sweat, and tears, but we made it look easy because of the passion.
Right.
The teams come together with a single cause, a common vision, and it was very fulfilling to work on.
Well, something else I think that I know that you were a part of, and Christina and others, that was fulfilling was, people may not know this, but the Ryzen, when you combine Ryzen and Ryzen Threadripper, it was the largest sampling to reviewers ever, I've done the math, of silicon out to be reviewed and tested all around the world. And enthusiasts, they do say to one another, let's wait for the reviews, wait till you really see the product before you buy. And that's part of why the team leaned into that so heavily. Talk to us a little bit about what it takes to be able to sample thousands of processors with innovative kits that go to reviewers and the rest. Maybe you first, Christina, on that.
Sure. So we wanted to really challenge ourselves to do something the industry hadn't seen before. So starting with the Threadripper packaging, all the way through to the kits that lit up when you opened them, and really give the reviewer and their audiences a special experience when they got this one of a kind product.
Yeah. So James, how do you do the sort of the math on, it's a lot of work to sample that many processors, plus we sampled all the major motherboard makers through that whole process. Talk a little bit about, as you've advocated for that idea of wanting so many reviewers to get to test and validate the goodness of the product.
Well, I think it really came down to the business goal that we had in mind. We wanted to disrupt the PC industry, change the face of gaming and streaming and multitasking and bringing new levels of performance to a price point and just changing what had been before, innovation, true newness into the market. And that doesn't happen by being reticent. You have to be bold. And AMD is a company that is bold, always. Stepping forward, doing the right thing. So it really was a simple conversation. It came down to the logistics of how do we fund this, and that's a really easy conversation, right? If everybody's agreed you need to do it and it's just a matter of money, it gets done. And that's why we were all the partners were engaged, bringing all these new motherboards, bringing these new features, getting these processors out there. We moved the memory guys to get the new products out for us. There's hundreds of memory kits now that are validated for Ryzen. That doesn't happen because you just say, would you mind? It happens because everybody believes they need it, they want it. And that's where all of that passion and excitement came from, and the reason and the need to do that sampling program.
That's so well said. And you talked there about, something that's new and something that's bold. So Suzanne, and also for you, Mike, we think about, what is Zen? Zen is an x86 processor. And then we think about, well, what is x86? Well, our phones aren't that useful in terms of the data that needs to be delivered to them without x86. Not much high performance research happens in the world without x86. the future of mixed reality, augmented reality, virtual reality is predicated on x86 technology today. And so when you think about how important that is to all of us, and then you think about Zen as a major moment where we breathe new competitive spirit into the marketplace, how do you think about kind of the significance of Zen when you think about the grander significance of x86?
Well, I mean, you know, we talked a little bit about this before. It's that there really wasn't a competition before.
Yeah.
And competition is always a good thing.
Yes.
And it's there now. And you can feel it within our company too. Just when you walk around, this is like, we are back, we're in this space. I think that, you know, the people on our forefront in marketing and sales feel that too when they go out to talk to people. Is, you know, we get a lot more reception. We get
yes.
a lot of people interested
it's
in
fun.
Us. And I mean, yeah. You know, it's really, I love the fact that I worked on it. It really makes me so happy and so proud to be able to look back and say that I was part of that. It's a great feeling.
Okay, I love hearing that. And so Mike, for you, maybe the same question about how you view Zen in that grand scheme of things, but also the importance of, you know, Zen Plus, Zen 2, Zen 3, when you think about continuing to build on that moment.
Yeah, I mean, the reality is it's kind of scary when you go and look at it, but in the data center, I mean, there's been a 40% compound annual growth rate of performance that's been delivered. You know, it's a combination of more cores, lower power, more effective frequencies, the software component, all of it. But that's actually what's been happening, and that's what the market expects.
Yes.
So while that looks daunting, that's the challenge we have every day coming in, knowing that's what we have to be doing. If we're not building a roadmap to do that, we're not going to be in the game, because that's what the market is used to and is requiring. So
yes,
it's very exciting. You know, as an architect, I'm already working on Gen 5, actually.
That was so. Actually where I was going next.
But yes,
there's a time machine to come back and pass for us to talk about.
It is kind of scary also that it takes so long for these projects that I have to be working on Gen 5 to be able to intersect it. But I mean, like you said in your first question as well, I mean, the interaction with software, getting in there and learning from those guys in that aspect, gaming, but you know, we see so much opportunity going forward by having that close tie to software of where we can extract that 40% compound annual growth rate over
yes.
time.
So. Okay, that's great. So speaking of opportunity, Christina, one of the things that's also happened in the last year is, you know, we launched Ryzen initially in the component channel where people built enthusiast PCs and that type of thing with it, but Ryzen's footprint in the marketplace has grown since then. Can you talk a little bit about that?
Yeah, it's been really exciting to see Ryzen come out in thin and light notebooks in the retail space. We're going to be bringing out some notebooks in commercial very soon, next quarter, and even desktops in both retail and business. So being able to bring that technology beyond the enthusiast is really broadening our reach and bringing it into every home and office.
And then ideally bringing a pretty significant performance increase and better experience at, you know, good energy efficiency to all of those end users, and the feedback has been, I think, very good on that. You were telling me something about what the average rating is for a
yes.
Ryzen processor with consumers on retail sites.
Yeah, so we went through and we combed the retail sites worldwide, and our rating from users who are actually, you know, have purchased the product is at 4.86 stars across the world.
Out of five,
yes.
I think something I can tee off with that, maybe coming over to you, James, is maybe what's next. So we're clearly in the window where we just passed the 1 year anniversary with Ryzen. We've said a little bit about a second generation of Ryzen. What can you tell us?
Well, the second generation is where, you know, we're going to deep dive some of the learnings that Mike found out, right? If you look at the initial reception to Ryzen, very positive, but also some challenges. You know, gaming performance, people wanted to see even more. And so we took a look. What are the things inside gaming that we can do to improve? So there's optimizations, all the great things that we can do working with developers on the software side, improve there. But what about inside the silicon? Is there something we can do there? Well, we can improve memory latency. We can improve cache latency. We can improve core frequencies. We can make it so that it's smarter than ever. So that if workload on the chip itself is running at the highest possible throughput or responsive rate, and that's second gen Ryzen.
Fantastic. And coming in April, I
yeah,
believe?
April.
Yes, okay. All right. Cannot wait. And fits in the same infrastructure as Ryzen.
Absolutely,
correct?
Fully backwards compatible. So today's existing PCs, motherboards that are available today, just a simple software update for the firmware, drop it right in and go. We already started that process with the processors we launched in February with our APUs, our Ryzen processors with Radeon graphics. It's going to be the same exact mechanism, but we also have brand new 400 series chipset motherboards that are optimized for the second generation, really dialed in for memory compatibility, CPU support, overclocking, new storage technologies. It's going to be a fantastic new platform that's still the same platform. It's just going to work backwards and forwards very simply and easily.
Yeah, one of the amazing things you told me that we have to, you know, give credit to Suzanne and Mike and the engineering teams is I think you were telling me that there are four product families already that fit into the AM4. Infrastructure, is that correct?
It is. We have we've got an A-series APU, we've got the first gen Ryzen, we've got the Ryzen with Radeon Vega graphics, now we have the second gen Ryzen. That's four distinct individual products in a single socket, in a single family. And we've taken all the complexity and the burden of trying to make all that work away from the consumer and brought it onto our own backs. So sorry, it's hard for you guys, but it has a benefit, right? The consumers like this. They want this scalability, they want the long term. That's why people love both Threadripper and Ryzen's, because they see a stable future here where it's just going to work and it's going to be good. And that's the most important thing.
Well, I just want to close by congratulating each of you on the success that has been Ryzen as well as Epic. I'd like to think that the five of us will get together a year from now and be as amazed by where we are and great things that have happened for you guys professionally as well as for the product in the marketplace and all the enthusiasm that I hope that we continue to generate in the market. So thanks you guys very much for your time.
Thank you.